says, oh, circuit breaker has blown out, so we need to do something different. So we went through a lot of work for the next 48-40 hours to rectify the problem. He almost was ready to say, should I try the old trick of hammering the equipment with the hammer and kick it with my feet or something? Actually, the NASA Houston people were very mad on him that he can't do that. But anyway, so first time they couldn't do on that, but we didn't have any successful results. So we made a convincing approach to NASA that this should fly again. And with the permission of the NASA, we got a chance to fly this again after a few years, which is almost after 6 years of the first flight. The flight was pretty heavily booked. They have scheduled experiments on, so but we could get a chance again to fly. This was the second attempt on a similar crystal, but we made some changes to the seed crystals. Last time in the first Space Lab 3 mission, we did not use, we used cut seeds. Like we took a TGS crystal and cut a seed of a particular size to put it to grow. But then we realized later on that the polishing and cutting produces a lot of damage on the crystals. Because anytime you cut, even in the best way, the diamond saw or whatever, it scratches. Even if you polish it out, it scratches and defects and go away. So next time in IML mission, we decided that we're going to use natural seeds, which means uncut. And what I mean by uncut, but I'll show you in a minute, that the surface on which the crystal grew was the uncut face. The bottom side was the cut side. So this is a large number of people, as you probably will understand, that the shuttle experiment involves hundreds and hundreds of people. In our own scientific team, we had lots of people who are listed here on this slide. Dr. Agarwal from this department, Dr. Agarwal, actually joined during my Space Lab 3 experiment A&M, came from Penn State. It was nice of him to leave Pennsylvania and come to Alabama to help us out. Dr. Batra, who is still here, he was one of the co-head investigators. Dr. William Wilcox, who is now at the Clarkson University in Potsdam, New York. At that time, he was the Dean of Engineering, but now he's a regular professor. James Stollinger, he's worked for the company in California. For macro laser. He is the optics expert. A lot of work is very well known in the field of holography. Bruce Steiner is a X-ray crystallographer. He works at Brookhaven National Lab. And he is at the beam line, which is in Brookhaven, for synchrotron radiation. So he does a lot of space shuttle crew. The crew is important. You will say the crew is not, they are not crystal grower. Crew, which flew normal Thagard, is a very versatile person. You know, he is a PhD in electrical engineering. He is an MD. He is the most qualified astronaut I know of, who has so many degrees. You know, he has an MBA. So he, then we trained him, and they are very smart people. So once they work in a lab for a week, they can mimic a scientist who has done work for many, many years. And then lots of graduate students. The objectives of our experiment was to grow crystals of a material called triglycine sulfate. And the reason we chose this material, because this material has been studied for many, many years. And there are hundreds of papers in the literature for this material. So we don't want to pick up a material which is not known to people, but a brand new material. Then we'll have to dig up starting ground-based data work. So we picked a material which is well known, and we thought we can improve the crystal, the quality of these crystals from making better. This is a material which is used for thermal detectors. And thermal means that when you shine a light on it, it develops heat, and the heat is converted into electrical signals, and then you can detect. The most common use which you see in a commercial market, which all of you probably, I don't know whether you've seen it, it is used for fire detection, and we use for sensors in the room. If I put a sensor of TGS on the entrance door here, and when you enter the door, your body heat can change the temperature sensing, and you can detect that somebody is intruding in your house. population. So they are commercially available in the market, but their efficiency is not as good, and we are trying to develop this. We wanted to perform the holographic interferometric tomography of the fluid field. When the crystal is growing in a chamber, when the crystal grows at a point, for example, if this is a chamber solution and fill in this, and you put a seed crystal here on a rod, when the crystal grows, there is a change in concentration field around the crystal. So we wanted to measure that how the fluid field is around the crystal. So we are using holographic technique, and this is the first time a holographic technique was done in space during this mission. And never even a laser has gone. So our first approach was to see whether the laser will work in space. But we were worried that the lasering action in a vacuum will not perform. So we flew this laser, helium neon laser, which was used for this technique, in a NASA, what they call KC-135 flight, where a Boeing 47 goes up and goes down like that. So in a downward motion of the Boeing 747, there is a low gravity for about 35 to 40 seconds. So we tested the laser during that mission, the KC-135 flight, just to make sure that the laser doesn't work. It will be embarrassing that if you send the laser to space and it doesn't work, you will be criticized and you will be sad. Sorry. So, and also we wanted to study the fluid motion to calculate the fluid velocity of the crystal field in this space. So what we did, that we put some particles in the fluid. The particles of the size of 300 micron, 400 micron, and 600 micron. And these are polystyrene particles, which was filled into the cell. And when the particles move in space, due to some reason, they will not move because of gravity, because there is almost very low gravity. They will move because of diffusion, because the temperature changes in the cell will make the particles to move. And we wanted to study the influence of the G-jitter. G-jitter means that the variation of the gravity. And the variation of the gravity takes place because astronauts, if the shuttle flies at a constant altitude all the time, then there is a constant G level. Whatever the value is, 10⁻⁶ G or 10⁻⁵ G or 4 G. But if the shuttle cannot fly all the time on the constant level, but it makes maneuvers, because firing thrusters or some rockets which are fired, and that creates the variation of the G. Even the astronauts, when they are doing on a treadmill for the exercise and monitoring their structural health, they need to do exercise, otherwise, so they go on treadmill, they do all kinds of exercise, machines and whatever, and that creates G level changes. Even if they sneeze, that takes a G level change in this patient. So we wanted to see that, and we have a complete record, exact timeline of the shuttle, time of the launch to the end. We know when the astronauts were on the treadmill, we know exactly when they were hit, whatever they noted, and then we can see by the particle motion that when the variation of the G took change. So it was the first time, I believe, in the history of NASA or any scientific research where the velocity of the fluid was measured in real time in space. And the particle motion and studies and the other pictures of the optical work was the front page of the cover of the Laser Focus magazine of that year. Because when this magazine saw our results, they requested us the permission to print that on the front page. So that was the cover sheet of the Laser Focus magazine in 1991. And the first question is that crystal growth of TGS, why do you want to grow in space? We will talk about it in a minute. Crystals were grown by a technique which we call as low temperature solution growth technique. The solution growth technique is very simple. You know, you take a solution saturated at a certain temperature, we are saturating at about 40 degrees Celsius, and then reduce the temperature down. And when you reduce the temperature down, the solution becomes supersaturated, and then it crystallizes. Just like you take a solution of sugar, a syrup, and heat it up, and then cool it down, you have sugar particles. So exactly the same idea, which is very simple. But that technique, if you do that experiment on ground, we have to do a lot of, we put the crystal and rotate and all that, and that doesn't work because rotation means we are changing the G levels, so we don't want. So we developed a technique which we call as a cool distinct technique, and we published a paper in 1983, and that was used for this experiment. There was a special equipment which was built, it was called fluid experiment system, which was used for the IML mission. And this is a system in which there was a crystal growth cell, and the entire optics part of the holography, the laser beam was there, and all the optics, you can imagine, different mirrors and lenses and so on. And everything was contained in one unit, and that was the fluid experiment system. The crystals were grown on the 010 oriented seed, and you might ask that why did we choose this? Because this is the fastest growing phase of TGS crystal. If you look at the crystal morphology, there are many faces. This is a monoclinic crystal. So this crystal has 010 phase, or in phase is the fastest growing. And since the time of the shuttle is only about 6 days, we wanted to use a phase which is, and incidentally it also happens that this is the phase on which detectors are fabricated. So we thought that once we grow a crystal on this phase, I don't have to do polishing, cutting, nothing. We can just fabricate detector right on the surface. So we choose this, and this was different than a Space Lab 3. We did not use 010 in the Space Lab 3. The growth seed, we use the growth seed phase natural. Crystals were grown from 40 degrees Celsius. Under cooling of about was maintained, and a fluid flow was monitored by particles of 200, 400, 600 micron sizes, and the growth was monitored in real time using video technique, Schirrer technique. One of the optical techniques. Particle motions were recorded through holograms. Now the next question comes, why microgravity? If you look at the, if anybody here is a fluid mechanics person or has done some fluid mechanics basic studies, there is a term which we call as Grassof number, which comes in the denominator, numerator of the equation of the fluid velocity. So Grassof number is determines that how stable the system is. So if you look at the equation for the Grassof number, it has the term of length, it has the term of viscosity, it has the term for the G. So there are various terms. One can do the same experiment which you do on the space by designing a system which is almost about 1000 times more viscous. Like you take a fluid which is 1000 times more viscous, you are actually losing the whole thing by 10 to minus 3. One can do that, but that is not practical. You cannot have a solution which is 1000 times more viscous, the crystal won't grow. Or you can have a system which is very small. If I grow a crystal in a capillary tube, which is very small, I reduce 1000 times the size of the chamber, then I can also create, I don't have to go in space. But all these things are not practical. And that is why we chose that we can reduce the G, which also comes in the equation, to that level, and we can attain a Grassof number which gives you streamlined conditions, not any buoyant, not any turbulence. Because the Grassof number determines the turbulence in the fluid mechanics. So once we go at a G level which is low, one can do that. So that is one of the reasons. So if you look at the number one thing in a space is we eliminate the buoyancy driven convection. The convection effects are reduced. It's never zero, but they are reduced. We establish a diffusion control condition. On ground, if you do any experiment, crystal growth experiment, you have two things competing. One is the gravity, which brings the fluid down. One is the diffusion. And you cannot eliminate either of the two. But in a space, one can eliminate the or reduce the convection to a great level. But so then we can establish a diffusion control. And it turns out that